Hello friends, in this lecture, we will discuss the India-Russia bilateral relationship, and what we'll be doing in this lecture, try and arrive at a historical understanding of India and Russia bilateral relationship, and we will be looking at the historical perspective also with the understanding as to how recently has the India-Russia bilateral relationship undergone a significant amount of change. We look at the historical closeness of the relationship between the erstwhile Soviet Union and India, and also how in the post-Cold War era has the relationship between the two giants changed. And as we move forward, let me also make this clear to you. Often you will not find questions directly coming from India-Russia bilateral relationships in your mains examination. However, Russia will be playing an important role whenever you're looking, for example, at even India-China relationships. Or there can be questions in your mains examination about, say, the close alignment of Russia-China relationship, and how does it impact the bilateral relationship between India and Russia. Or there can be questions also about, for example, the recent frostiness between the West and Russia, and how Russia's tilting towards China has implications for India-Russia relationships. So these kind of questions can be asked. Also, there are certain important aspects about India-Russia relationships that we look into, especially with respect to the defense sector, also with respect to the economic sector. And in this way, try and understand the complexity of the situation here. Also, we would want you to understand that what we'll be discussing is some of the recent initiatives up till the start of 2016. But you should keep a close watch in the newspapers after going through this lecture, because certain new developments are often asked in the mains examination. So this should provide a firm, basic understanding of the bilateral relationship between India and Russia. Now, as we look at the chapter outline, looking at India-Soviet Union relationship during the Cold War era, especially we look at the significance of the 1971 Treaty of Peace, Friendship and Cooperation. Then we look at India and Russia relations in the post-Cold War era. And specifically, we look at the post-Crimean situation that arose, especially with the Ukraine crisis that Russia has found itself in, and how it is, for example, the current state of the Russian economy and its closer tilting towards China has implications on India-Russia relationships also. And specifically, we'll be looking at the defense and economic issues with respect to the bilateral relationships. Also, we'll be looking at what can be done to strengthen India-Russia relationship in the future. Now, as we move forward in this lecture, something that we also saw when we were discussing India-US relationship is the whole issue of the Soviet era and the historical legacy of India-Soviet relationship, which actually laid a very firm foundation for the bilateral relationship, and which does continue to have a significant effect on the bilateral front even today. So for India, the Soviet Union, as we've discussed, for example, even when we were discussing India-USA, that the bilateral relationship between India and Soviet Union has actually played a historic role, providing India much needed support at the international level. And in spite of having a so-called non-alignment policy, India's close relationship with India has cultivated a close or so-called a special relationship with the Soviet Union during the Cold War era. And this close relationship with the Soviet Union came very handy for India, especially in dealing with the twin adversaries, both Pakistan and China during the 60s, and especially during the Bangladesh War of 1971. So there has been thus a sense of a strong relationship between the two countries, especially during the 1960s and 70s. And for the Soviet Union, the ties with India were aimed at counterbalancing the Chinese and American influence in the region, as well as securing important support amongst the third world states via the Indian leadership of the non-alignment movement. Now, one of the things that was often missed in a discussion about India-Russia relationship is what motivated the Soviet Union to closely align actually strengthen its relationship with India. On the one hand was that India was, in one way or the other, the professed leader of the non-aligned group. And the non-aligned group, which didn't align either with the Soviet Union or with the Western countries. Now, at this point of time, given India's historic leadership role of the NAM movement, and given Soviet Union's close relationship with India, the cultivation of close relationship with India allowed the Soviet Union to ensure that the newly independent countries of Africa and Asia did not were not forced to join or did not succumb to the temptations of joining the Western bloc during the Cold War era. Though most of the NAM countries didn't join even Soviet Union. But one of the aims cultivating closer relationship with India was that India could play an important role in preventing a lot of these NAM countries from following in the Western camp. So, also, another important reason, which often a lot of people underestimate is the role played by the friction between Soviet Union and China, especially during the 1960s, which actually ensured Soviet Union support for the Indian dispensation. Now, the Soviet Union and China had, anybody who studied global history after World War II finds that the Soviet-China dispute were on a number of matters, including crucially who should be the true leader of the international communist movement during the Cold War. The Chinese under Mao considered themselves to be the true inheritors of Lenin's legacy considered themselves to be the true leaders of the communist movement. So there was a considerable friction between the Soviet Union and China as to who should be considered as the true leader of the international communist movement. Also, there were border disputes between Soviet Union and China, which led to considerable friction, especially during the late 1960s, between Soviet Union and China, and brought and this also motivated the Soviet Union to cultivate India as a counterbalance to China to whatever extent possible. And also, given the 1962 India-China war, Soviet Union was aware of India's sensitivities towards China. That is why India-Soviet Union partnership also gained momentum, especially after the India-China war of 1962 and the border crisis between Soviet Union and China during the late 1960s. Now, on the other hand, what also motivated a more closely aligned relationship between India and Soviet Union was the fact that Pakistan was being cultivated at the height of the Cold War during the 1960s as an active ally of United States, something that we had discussed when we were seeing India-US relationships during the Cold War era. Pakistan was being cultivated as an important influence, as an important partner in South Asia by United States. And India was looking with much deep suspicion about the closeness of US-Pakistan relationship. And though Pakistan was just sought to be cultivated by United States as an anti-communist measure, or more importantly, as an anti-Soviet measure, Pakistan did align itself closely with United States, joining the SEATO, the Southeast Asian Treaty Organization, and later the CENTO, both military alliances in West Asia, which were closely aligned with the US-backed Western groups and as a counter to the Union and the Communist bloc. So, also, India felt threatened by the closeness of US-Pakistan relationship, as India feared, lead to sidelining of India within South Asia, and India had historically considered South Asia as its own backyard. So it is in this context also that the Soviet support was proving crucial. Also, as we've seen, even from 1955 onwards and over a period of time, India received strong support from the Soviet Union in the United Nations Security Council, especially over the Kashmir question. And India's position on Kashmir was endorsed by the Soviet Union, thus acting as a major backer on the Kashmir question at the International Forum for India. So the Soviet support outside the United Nations and a threat to use veto inside the Security Council acted as an umbrella against the Western pressure, which was more closely aligned to the Pakistani position on the Kashmir question. And this Soviet policy of close and friendly relationships with India remained singularly stable despite some problems here and there. And in 1955, the Soviet Union strongly accepted strongly accepted the position that Kashmir was an integral part of India, and Moscow became an indispensable source of supply of military hardware not available elsewhere. Now, as India found itself closely aligning as India found itself strongly supported by Soviet Union on the Kashmir question, also the crucial aspect of military preparedness of India also became important. Now, the crucial aspect of military preparedness of India became important, and again, Soviet Union became a major supplier of defense weapons to India, and even at its the whole 1960s, 70s and 80s, India's singularly important defense partner was the Soviet Union, which was responsible for almost 80% of the military modernization of the Indian forces and became one of the single most important military hardware suppliers, which was crucial in strengthening India's military apparatus. So while the United States to bring Pakistan within its fold to be used as a counter-Soviet ally in the region, and then later to ensure that Western groups could arm the Taliban during the Soviet Union invasion of Afghanistan, use Pakistan as a valuable source to counter the Soviet Union in Afghanistan, and thus provided military support as well as financial support to the Pakistani army, was acting in one way against India's interests. On the other hand, the Soviet Union became an important source of supplier of weapons and weapon systems to India, thus filling a crucial gap in India's defense preparedness. So that was also an important reason which had actually historically brought India and Soviet Union together during the Cold War era. Also, the Soviet Union adopted, at the height of the 1962 India-China dispute, the Soviet Union adopted a neutral position, refusing to take a position which was in favor of China, in spite of China being a communist regime. And as border clashes erupted between China and India in 1959, the Soviet Union called for direct negotiations between the two sides to settle the problem, angering the Chinese and pleasing India, because it came as a shock to Chinese in 1959 that the Soviet Union did not adopt a pro-China position on the border dispute question. So that also became a source of relief that the Soviet Union was not supporting China on the border question. Also, after the 1965 war between India and Pakistan, again, on that when the matter of negotiations came and the Tashkent Agreement was signed, the Soviet Union assured that nothing would be put in the agreement that could be against India's interests, and India appreciated the support of Soviet Union, which provided clear assurances, and the Soviet Union was the mediator for the Tashkent Agreement, and the Soviet Union provided clear assurances that India's interests would not be compromised at any cost in the agreement which was to be concluded after the 1965 war. And then finally, we came to the 1971 war. But before that, even after 1965 only, India and Soviet Union had started adopting similar positions on key questions at the international forum. For example, India and Soviet Union adopted exactly similar positions on the Vietnam question, and termed the US bombing of Vietnam as illegal and strongly registered their opposition. On the other hand, as we had discussed when we were discussing India-US relationships, that the Soviet Union invasion of Hungary in 1956 and then of Czechoslovakia in 1968, these were our Soviet Union's interventions in Hungary in 1956 and in Czechoslovakia in 1968 to curb pro-democracy protests were not opposed by India openly, and India did not actually vote against the Soviet Union in the United Nations on both the Soviet intervention in Hungary and the Soviet intervention in Czechoslovakia to curb pro-democracy protests. So it is in this context, at the height of the Cold War, India adopted and India tilted towards the Soviet Union in spite of its professed non-alignment policy. And then matters came to head with the 1971 war, and as I just told you, that the Indo-Soviet Union Friendship Treaty played a very crucial role in ensuring, in preventing the US intervention, in preventing the Chinese intervention, and ensuring that India got enough time to play a decisive role in the 1971 war, and also in the liberation of Bangladesh itself. So, at the height of the increasing tensions between India and Pakistan, especially in the area of East Pakistan, then East Pakistan, and the whole deterioration of the Bangladesh question, that is in greater detail that we've discussed in India-Bangladesh relationship. At just a few months before the start of the India-Bangladesh war, India actually finalized the friendship treaty Friendship Treaty with Soviet Union, which was also known as the India-Soviet Union Treaty of, which we'll repeat again, which was also known as the Soviet Indian Treaty of Peace, Friendship and Cooperation, and which was signed in 1971 and was supposed to be operational for a period of 20 years. Now, India had concluded this friendship treaty with Soviet Union. It didn't conclude any of such friendship treaties with the United States. And a lot of observers pointed out that India's conclusion of such a formal friendship treaty with Soviet Union actually somehow raises question about its non-alignment policy. But nonetheless, India firmly went ahead and completed this friendship treaty. What was so crucial about the friendship treaty was that as the tensions which led up to the 1971 war were building up, United States made its position very clear that if at all a country such as China intervened on behalf of Pakistan on the war front in East Bangladesh, in East Pakistan, then United States would not interfere. Basically, what United States was trying to tell to India indirectly was if there was any intervention by China in support of Pakistan in case of any war between India and Pakistan, then in that condition, United States would not intervene. What tacitly in a covert manner, US was doing was, it was endorsing Pakistan and China against India. And it is at this context, and it is at this point of time that the Soviet Union support came as a major source of relief, because the treaty that India signed for 20 years in 1971, because the treaty ensured that both the countries will help each other in times of need. In times of need, meaning that in case there is a war, firstly, neither India nor Soviet Union will indulge in activities which are detrimental to each other. So that meant the Soviet Union would not come to China's assistance or to Pakistan's assistance in case of any dispute between India and Pakistan or India and China. And more importantly, it went on to say that if at all India faces a distress situation, or if at all Soviet Union faces a distress situation, both the countries will help each other out and can use any and all options to help each other out. That is, the high contracting parties had immediately entered into a mutual consultation in order to remove any threat and to take effective measures to ensure peace and security of their countries. What basically the 1971 treaty gave to India was assured military assistance in case the US intervened or in case China intervened in the war between India and Pakistan. So it was thus that the India's 1971 treaty was thus an effective balance of power strategy that India used. It provided an insurance of Soviet diplomatic support as well as military support to India in case of any outbreak of war between India and Pakistan. And so just months after the conclusion of treaty, when a full-blown war broke out between India and Pakistan on the question of East Pakistan or on the question of liberation of Bangladesh, the Soviet Union the recently concluded treaty with Soviet Union came handy. The Soviet Union vetoed a number of Security Council resolutions which were introduced against India in the United Nations, and provided an insurance of Soviet diplomatic support in the United Nations if the issue reached the world body. Now, once the war started, the Soviet Union made it clear in the United Nations that India was not the aggressor against Pakistan. A deteriorating security situation in East Bangladesh and the migrant problem and the whole issue of migrants and war displaced migrants which were being entering into the northeastern portion of India mandated an Indian intervention, and it was a human rights crisis situation that was actually also likely to affect India's stability of India's northeast. And on these grounds, India was well within its right to intervene in the situation, and India was not the aggressor in the 1971 war. And so Soviet Union attributed the sole responsibility for the 1971 war to Pakistan and warned other governments to avoid getting involved in the conflict. And thus, Soviet Union provided an assured military as well as diplomatic support to India at a very crucial time. And given India's, and this gave India crucial time in consolidating its military position in East Pakistan, the Soviet Union vetoed the UN resolutions calling for a ceasefire and the withdrawal of Indian forces from East Pakistan or Bangladesh. So the Soviet Union supported the United Nations of vetoing proposals for installation of immediate ceasefire. It gave India valuable days, which played a very important role in allowing Indian forces along with the Bangladeshi Liberation Movement forces to settle the matter conclusively and to oust the the Pakistani army from Bangladesh and enforce a surrender in the 1971 war. And at the peak of tensions, when the United States dispatched the USS Enterprise to actually threaten India that unless and until India backs off, the US Navy may intervene in favor of Pakistan. The Soviet Union also dispatched naval vessels to counter possible US intervention in the area. So yes, at the height of the 1971 war, the Cold War came pretty close to South Asia. But given the Soviet Union's firm support to India, India got crucial time to enforce a Pakistani surrender even before the US Navy could intervene. And thus, India's military victory would not have been possible in the 1971 war without the deterrent posture adopted by the Soviet Union vis-a-vis the extra-regional powers in the region. So, if you see, thus such a valuable role has been played by Soviet Union, and that is what, you know, even after the disintegration of the Soviet Union, even after the Cold War era has ended and the so-called historic tensions of Cold War eras have ended, and even when India is warming up to the United States and United States is warming up to India, the historical legacy of India-Russia relations is such that it has continued despite India's strengthening of relationships with the United States. However, the disintegration of the Soviet Union in 1990 and the end of the Cold War meant that the situation on ground changed drastically. Rather than having a bipolar world would mean that the United States camp on the one side and the Soviet Union camp on the other side. Rather than having a bipolar world which had two major superpowers, now was the world where there was only one superpower, and that was the United States. And the disintegration of Soviet Union meant that the world became from a bipolar world to a unipolar world. And at this point of time, thus, the disintegration of Soviet Union left Russia much weaker than at the height of the strength of the communist movement. Also, was the result was that the weak Russia, at least during the whole 1990s, was much wary of US being the sole superpower, and Russia was actively looking forward to cultivate cultivate groupings that could act as an effective counterweight to US at the world level, and that could challenge US hegemony. And at this point of time, China had already been a rising power, and Russia was looking at some sort of alliance which could be made between Russia, India and China. And that is when the Russian Prime Minister in 1998 actually formally proposed a plan for a Russia-India-China trilateral to counter the US hegemony. And this was proposed by the Russian Prime Minister Primakov at that point of time, and was known as the Primakov plan also. However, even when the idea was initially proposed, there was not much movement on the ground level to actually give this idea concrete reality. But Russia, you know, the proposal of the RIC plan, or the Russia-India-China trilateral grouping, was evident that Russia was looking towards China as well as India to act as a counter against the United States at the international level. However, this idea didn't materialize in any significant manner. India went on to sign the strategic partnership with Russia in 2000. Also, Russia was thus one of the first countries with which India signed such a strategic partnership. Then, after 10 years, it was upgraded to a special and privileged strategic partnership. So this all points out how India did continue to remain important, and Russia also continued to remain important to India, especially, for example, in the defense sphere, even in the 1990s. But when it came to the matter of economics, the fact that India was opening up its economy in a big way allowed US businesses to enter in the Indian market in a big way, but the Russian businesses and the collaboration between Indian and Russian businesses did not pick up in any significant manner. Also, this was also because of the tremendous crisis that the Russian economy was going through the whole 1990s. So the economic aspect of relationship between Russia and India did not pick up in any significant manner in the post-Cold War era. Also, if you see recently, you see, after 2012-13 onwards, you have had a series of crises that Russia has found itself embroiled in. Firstly, the Ukrainian crisis and the whole issue of annexation of Crimea, which has actually led to a revival of tensions between the West and Russia, especially over the Crimea question. And that has also seen the imposition of financial sanctions by European countries as well as the United States against Russia. Now, this has hurt the Russian economy. On top of that, the Russian economy to a large extent has been dependent upon defense exports as well as the export of hydrocarbons. Given the fact that, given the crash in the crude oil prices, again, Russian economy is dealing with a severe crunch at this point of time. And also on the other hand, United States tension have been increasing, especially over the issue of sovereignty and sovereignty related issues in the South China Sea and East China Sea. So the increasing US-China tensions, and more importantly, the extremely heightened tensions between United States and Western European countries and Russia has seen Russia tilting more and more towards China. And this has actually raised much concern in New Delhi. So the recent Crimean crisis, the imposition of sanctions, economic sanctions on Russia by Western countries, and the falling crude oil prices has forced Russia to look eastward for energy markets, for finding new energy markets, and has seen a closer alignment of Russia and China. For example, if you see that on the economic aspect today, China is the biggest economic partner of Russia. Also, Russia has recently concluded a mega gas deal for supplying more than 38 billion cubic feet of gas to China over the next 20 to 30 years, rather. And this is a significant deal which has played a very important role in keeping alive the Russian hydrocarbon-based economy. In the absence of such a deal, the Russian economy would have suffered a lot, given the fact that Russian oil and gas exports historically had been majorly directed at Western European countries. But the Western European countries have reduced their oil imports from Russia, given the sanctions imposed by the Western economy on the question of Crimea. And this has forced Russia to look for markets elsewhere, especially towards Eastern countries, to ensure that its hydrocarbon-based economy doesn't collapse. And China has emerged as the biggest market where Russia is looking for collaboration with China and has actually signed two mega gas deals with China in the span of 3 years. And these are gas deals which are huge in terms of the economic impact, which can singularly, given the volumes that Russia is looking at exporting to China through these gas pipeline deals, is going to play a very important role in keeping the Russian economy alive. So Russia is actually tilting significantly towards China. And given the fact that Russia historically has been a major supplier of defense weapons and has actually played a very important role in supporting India and has played an important role in assuring India that it would come to India's rescue, given the fact of overbearing and aggressive China in India's immediate neighborhood, the closer alignment of Russia and China has raised many concerns in the Indian strategic community. So this has to be kept in mind. So also you would see, for example, that Russia and China have adopted recently similar positions in the United Nations Security Council on important crucial questions at the international level, such as the Syrian crisis, and have supported the Assad regime on the same. Also, what has happened recently is, for example, the nuclear crisis in Iran. And the resolution of and the current diplomatic negotiations to resolve the nuclear standoff in Iran and Iran's nuclear enrichment program has also come about because of Russia and China steadfastly opposing the imposition of even more stiffer sanctions against Iran and Iran's nuclear enrichment program. So you see, Russia and China have been closely aligning their position on international questions. Also, given the fact that India has in the recent past also diversified more in terms of its sources from which it imported defense weapons, that has also been diversified in the recent past. On the one hand, you find that there has been a warming up of India-US defense partnership. Also, the 2005 India-US civilian nuclear deal. At the same point of time, not just India is looking to India started import of defense weapons from United States, such as the C-130J. Globemasters and other military aircrafts. Apart from that, India has also diversified its defense imports, especially from countries like Israel, which has been a traditional US ally. Also, for example, the recent huge multimodal MMRCA aircraft deal for the import and the manufacture of 126 stealth aircrafts France is the country which has actually won the contract, and Russia has actually not been able to back that contract also. So you see that in spite of historically being the biggest supplier of weapon systems in India, earlier Russia used to supply almost up to 80% of defense weapons in India. The Russian share today has been reduced to 70%, but still it continues to be the biggest supplier. And though in the past 3 or 4 years, the Russians had somewhat lagged behind as compared to the United States and Israel with terms of weapon system supply to India. But again, after the December 2015 visit of Narendra Modi to Russia, things have again started swinging in Russia's favor, and India is looking to strengthen its defense collaboration with Russia. So you see that there is a considerable amount of Russia and China coming together on important questions. Also, there is a considerable amount of friction between Russia and the West, also between China and the West, especially on the South China Sea dispute. And also, importantly, there has been a warming up of India's relationship with the West, especially with the United States. In the economic arena, India-US economic trade stands at $100 billion today, whereas India-Russia economic trade stands at $10 billion today. But it would also be insufficient, and it would be short-sighted to compare India's relationship with Russia and India's relationship with United States only in terms of economic needs, because the historical legacy of India-Russia relations has been such that the Soviet Union and then Russia has been a traditional supporter of India on a large number of crucial questions. So that also weighs down on the Indian strategic establishment. And even today, India-Russia is ready to share the kind of sensitive weapon systems technology with India that no other country is ready to share. For example, the nuclear powered submarines. Now, Russia has been ready to lease out nuclear powered submarines to India, which no other country has been ready to do that till now. So you see that even today, Russia continues, though there has continues to be an important player in India's foreign policy perspective, though it is not at the heights at which it was during the Cold War era. And though India has warmed up to the United States, but then also broadly it would be an exaggeration to say that Russia no longer enjoys prominence in Indian foreign policy. Russia continues to enjoy prominence in Indian foreign policy, though India has a much more diversified policy with terms of defense imports, and also India follows a much more multi-aligned or a multi-vector policy, foreign policy at the international level. Don't forget, also India is collaborating, India is an important partner in the BRICS community, where Brazil, Russia, India and China, all three of them come together. Now, finally, coming back to the economic aspect of the relationship, we are also looking at an aspect of relationship which is actually one of the weakest links in India-Russia relationships. Now, the economic aspect of the relationship continues to be actually the weakest links in Russia-India relationships, and also is that aspect of the bilateral relationship where there is much scope for strengthening the bilateral relationships. So the economic relationships that have the highest, the strongest scope for strengthening the bilateral relationship. And currently you see that, you know, as if you just put, you know, things in perspective, that for example, currently if you see that the India-Russia relationship, economic relationship, India-Russia economic relationship stands at a mere $10 billion per year. The initial target was actually, that by 2015 we were planning to reach a target of $20 billion per year, but that was definitely not reached. We're just halfway down. We're actually at $10 billion per year. And on the other hand, now when Modi recently went to Russia, the target has been increased, that over the next 10 years we are looking at tripling the bilateral trade to $30 billion per year. But when you compare, for example, India-US economic relationship, you find that India-US economic relationship already stands at $100 billion per year, and India is looking forward to push up over the next 10 years the bilateral trade to $500 billion per year. So you see that the magnitude of economic strength arm of the relationship is much stronger with United States than with Russia. On the other hand, the defense arm of the relationship is much stronger with Russia than with the United States. So that is something that has to be kept in mind. Also, for example, if you see that Russia's largest trading partner today is China, And even more so, given the financial sanctions being imposed against Russia and Russia's declining hydrocarbon trade with the Western European countries, Russia is increasingly becoming dependent upon China for its hydrocarbon sales. So China is now Russia's largest trading partner, and the two sides have also signed a 30-year agreement under which Russia will supply China with 68 billion cubic meters of gas annually from 2015 onwards. So you'll see that the closer economic strengthening of the bilateral relationship between Russia and China is also causing much concern in India. For the last thing that India wants is that its traditional, historically strong relationship with Russia gets weakened, and Russia is forced to become a junior partner in a relationship with China. So, and even Russia wants to avoid getting into a junior partner relationship with China in the long run. For example, Russia has been supportive of India. Even today, for example, Russia has supported the inclusion of India within the SCO or the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And Russia has supported the inclusion of India within the Shanghai Cooperation Organization as a permanent member. So even, so it is also in Russia's interest to actually cultivate friendship with India, especially in the economic sphere. Given the long-term strategic implications being that Russia does not want to become a junior partner with China in the long-term relationship. So that also has to be kept in mind. Now, thus, these are the potential areas of disturbance in the bilateral relationship. So what can be done? What can be done is that to strengthen the bilateral relationship with Russia, a much more strong and sustained emphasis on the economic arm of the relationship is needed, and the potential areas of cooperation in the economic arena are the hydrocarbon sector, the nuclear energy sector, and the gems and jewelry sector. Now, if you look at the hydrocarbon sector, India's largest or India's biggest offshore investment in any other foreign country in the hydrocarbon sector is done by Oil and Natural Gas Commission (ONGC) Videsh Limited in the Sakhalin gas project in Russia, and India has actually a 20% stake in the Sakhalin gas project in Russia. Already India had acquired that, and in 2015 when Modi went to Russia recently, ONGC has actually signed another contract for acquiring a 15% stake in Rosneft's Vankorneft field or Vankorneft gas field. So India, and so this aspect of the hydrocarbon cooperation sector also can be strengthened, given the fact that Russia is also looking to actually increase its hydrocarbon production, and India is also looking to make strategic investments in the hydrocarbon sector to ensure its energy security in the long term. So in that context, India and Russia has enough potential for cooperation in the hydrocarbon sector. Also, Russia also wants to ensure that it is not dependent only upon China as an export partner to actually export its hydrocarbon products. It also wants to diversify its export destinations from China, and India is actually a valuable partner for that. Needless to say, the only currently nuclear power plants which have been operationalized after the India-US civilian nuclear deal of 2005 are the Kudnakulam nuclear power plants. Even when the US nuclear power companies have expressed reservation with respect to India's civilian nuclear liability law, the Kudnakulam nuclear power plant is the only power plant which has, in the recent past, which has become operational, and it is the Kudnakulam power plant has actually been established by the Russians and India's, and the Russian investment in the FDI and the Russian FDI in the nuclear power plant arena has become operational, with Kudnakulam becoming the first nuclear power plant to become operational in the recent past. And also, at the recent visit of Prime Minister Modi to Russia, Russia has expressed willingness to supply 12 more nuclear reactors, and India is looking at giving Russia another site apart from Kudnakulam for the establishment of these nuclear reactors. Some of the possible sites which are being explored are in Andhra Pradesh. So you see that Russia is again in the area of nuclear energy cooperation. Also, Russia has been a traditionally strong partner, and Kudnakulam and the success of Kudnakulam also points out that even when India is actually negotiating how to operationalize and bring out the Jaipur power plant with France or the Mithi Verdi power plant with the United States, Westinghouse Nuclear Corporation, Russia has actually moved ahead and has been able to actually successfully implement the Kudankulam power plant also. Also, and a major area where India can be looking at a much stronger cooperation with Russia is in the area of gems and jewelry. Now, India and especially Surat and adjoining areas in Gujarat in India are a major site where polishing and finishing of gems and uncut diamonds takes place. And Russia is a huge source of uncut diamonds in the international market. So, export of uncut diamonds to India and the finishing of these uncut diamonds in India's gems and jewelry sector can also strengthen the bilateral arm of the economic relationship, given the fact that gems and jewelry is a labor-intensive industry, and thus it would also play an important role in employment generation in India and strengthening the sourcing of raw uncut diamonds for the polishing industry of gems and jewelries situated in Gujarat and India. These are aspects of economic relationships which can be strengthened. Now, overall, thus, what you need to keep in mind from your examination point of view, the point of possible questions that can be raised is critically analyze the changing nature of India-Russia relationship. So, whenever you're writing about the critical analysis about the changing nature of India-Russia relationship, then what you would be looking at is what has been the historical role of Russia in Indian foreign policy. Also, how in the area of defense cooperation, Russia continues to be an important partner, especially in co-development projects and joint development product projects in the defense arena. And how also the weakest aspect of India-Russia relationship has been the economic trade aspect. And also what needs to be done to strengthen the economic relationship between India and Russia, so as to also ensure that Russia is not forced into pivoting itself with China as the major partner in its foreign policy. And for that, India needs to increase its defense cooperation as well as economic cooperation, so as to ensure that India, especially in the area of hydrocarbon sector and the nuclear energy sector, can, and also in the area of gems and jewelry, can play an important role offering an important market for Russian goods also, and feeding the Russian goods into the Indian export market itself. Through the whole activities of gems and jewelries in the first place. Remember, India is a major exporter of finished gems and jewels, and Russia is a big source of supply of uncut diamonds, which can feed into India's gems and jewelry segment of economic market. So these are the kinds of questions which can be asked. Also, kinds of questions can be asked is, how is the changing nature of Russia and the West relationship impacting India's relationship with Russia? Now, the changing nature of and the polarization of between the West and Russia has actually been pushing Russia more in China's arm, and that has been a cause of concern for India. What can India be doing is actually strengthen its cooperation with Russia, especially in the economic arena and also in the hydrocarbon and the nuclear arena, and also in the defense arena, to ensure that Russia is not forced firmly into Chinese arm, because that is not something good for India's interest in the long run. So these are the kind of questions which can be asked. So all of this is important from your examination point of view. Keep this in mind as you go forward, and keep a close watch on the recent developments which happen, especially between the prelims and the mains examination. That would be useful. And with this much of background knowledge, I think that should be sufficient enough for helping to attempt any question in India-Russia relationship which appears in the mains examination.